State of California Executive Order N-29-20 dated March 17, 2020 regarding the COVID-19 pandemic. Planning commissioners and staff who have joined the meeting, please mute your microphones and unmute when called upon and acknowledged by the chairperson. Submission of public comment procedures in accordance with Executive Order N-29-20 and based on guidance from the California Department of Public Health, in order to minimize the spread of COVID-19 virus, city meetings may be observed live at https://salinas.register.com/calendar.aspx on the Salinas channel on YouTube at https://www.youtube.com/user/the Salinas channel. Advance submittal of public comments via email were due today at 1:30 p.m. to the Planning Commission Secretary at publiccomment.cd@ci.salinas.ca.us. If you are watching the live stream and wish to make either a general public comment or to comment on a specific agenda item as it is being heard, please join the Zoom webinar at https://zoom.us/j/92914039226. Webinar ID is 92914039226 or join by telephone at 1-669-900-6833. Webinar ID 92914039226. You may also submit your written comment limited to 250 words or less via emails to the Planning Commission Secretary at publiccomment.cd@ci.salinas.ca.us. Every effort will be made to read your comment into the record, but some comments may not be read due to time limitations. Reading of public comments. Public comments shall be read, provided that the reading shall not exceed 2 minutes. The email comments submitted shall become part of the record. Go ahead,
Commissioner Chairperson Meeks.
Mr. Meeks, you are muted.
Welcome, Rosa. We just read the public notice on how to be a part of this. So right now what we'll do is we have a quorum, so we'll call the meeting to order. And I'll lead you in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Could we have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Donahue?
Present.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Present.
Commissioner Luz? Commissioner Monzo?
Present.
Commissioner Noor?
Present.
Chairperson Meeks?
Present.
And Commissioner Griffin will not be joining us.
Okay. Let's have the welcoming of the staff and introductions, please.
Myra Flores, Administrative Aide.
Courtney Grossman, Planning Manager.
Tom Wiles, Senior Planner.
I see that Chris is on, but it's muted. Megan's on, but it's muted.
Sorry about that. Megan Hunter, Community Development Director.
And Chris Callahan, City Attorney.
And who's representing the City of Salinas? I guess no one at the moment. Okay. Planning Secretary, now read any general public communications received by email on items that are not on the agenda and that are in the City of Salinas subject matter jurisdiction. Comments on consent, consideration, and public hearing items should be held until the items are reached. Planning Secretary, is any comments from the public regarding items not on today's agenda?
No comment.
We'll start with consent, and Courtney, you had something to say about ID 21-004, which is the the telecommunications tower?
Yes, after we know the minutes, the first public hearing, staff recommends that the Planning Commission continue the item. It appears that there is some question about the application moving forward, and we suggest a continuance to the first meeting in February, which is February 3rd.
Any questions from the commissioners? And if not, do we have a motion to continue this item?
Chairperson Meeks, we skipped item ID 21-004, the minute.
That's what, Office had another thing in mind. Okay, item 21-004, approval of minutes of December 16, 2020 meeting. Any questions or comments from commissioners? Commissioner Donahue?
No questions.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
No questions.
Commissioner Manzo?
No questions.
Commissioner Knorr?
No questions or comments.
Okay, I have no questions or comments. Do we have a motion from a commissioner and a second for approval?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Awesome. Okay, we have a motion by Commissioner Donahue and a second by, I think it was Commissioner Knorr. And can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Donahue?
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Yes.
Commissioner Armanzo?
Aye.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yes.
Chairperson Meeks?
Yes. Now we'll move on to 20-580, which is the tower. And we've already been briefed on requests for a continuance. Are there any questions about that from any of the commissioners? And if not, we have a motion to continue this item.
I'll make a motion for a continuance.
We have a second.
I'll second.
Okay, with a motion by Commissioner Knorr and a second by Commissioner Manzo, can we have a roll call vote, please, for continuation?
Commissioner Donahue?
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Yes.
Commissioner Manzo?
Aye.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yes.
Chairperson Meeks?
Yes. So, Courtney, what date are we going to continue that to?
February 3.
February what?
February 3rd.
3rd. Okay, the item number 20-580 is continuing until the 3rd of February. Next item on the agenda, Zoning Code Amendment 20-002, ordinance to permit one renewal of a temporary use of land permit for temporary employee and interim housing in existing property developed as a hotel or a motel. Courtney, are you going to present the PowerPoint on this?
I'm actually going to hand this one over to Megan Hunter, director.
Okay.
Has offered to take this one on.
Okay, thank you. Megan?
Great, thank you. So before you is actually an amendment to something that the commission had passed in 2019. This is an amendment to the temporary use of land permit section of the zoning code. The original change was to allow for temporary employee and interim housing in existing properties developed as a motel or hotel, which was adopted in 2019. Myra, if you could move to the next slide. So as you may recall, we allowed for this use because currently under the zoning code, there's no ability to stay in housing beyond 28 days. This would actually allow for the use for employee or interim housing beyond that 28-day period. We were working on a modification to the extended stay ordinance that would have addressed this issue sort of more permanently beyond the temporary use of land permit process, but the pandemic basically hit and all of the staff had to switch into kind of providing emergency assistance, working with homelessness, working with food assistance, working with small business assistance. So we just didn't have the staff capacity to move forward with the more permanent change. And so what we're seeking to do is to allow for an additional renewal of up to 1 year, which would allow us to finish the work on the extended stay ordinance, which would come back before a planning commission and city council. And this is really important because it's helping to facilitate urgent short-term housing while we are able to address a permanent solution. And it does allow for, or it provides for operational standards for neighborhood protection. We are making one additional adjustment to the amendment to the inspection provisions. We actually realized the good news is when we've gone to inspect the facilities, they've been really maintained very well. They're also inspected. Many of them are being used through the H2A program, so they're also inspected by other entities, including the county. So what we found was that the facilities were in good shape, and it just became unnecessary to do as many inspections as we have done. We still will do 2 inspections instead of 3, but we are also seeking that modification. If you could move to the next slide. A little bit of background on this for the newer planning commissioners. This actually was a request that came from the city council to allow for this. The fear was that if we prohibited this use in hotel motels, it would flow into the neighborhoods and cause some issues and may compete with permanent farm worker for critical housing within the community. So this was a council direction to allow for this temporary use as we look towards a permanent solution in the hotel motels. We've met with a lot of stakeholder groups. Not only did we meet with the housing and CDBG subcommittee, which is now the housing and land use committee of city council, but we've also met with a coalition of housing advocates and agricultural producers and labor contractors to develop this proposal along with the hotel motel owners. This is part of the Salinas plan and farm worker housing study to look for ways of facilitating this type of housing. And as I mentioned before, the original change to the temporary use of land permit process occurred in March 2019. Okay, next slide. The one thing that is important to note is that there are a lot of conditions that are placed in the use. I mentioned that we do inspections. There are a lot of compatibility requirements. There's limited outdoor activity. There are performance standards that we integrated as part of this. We have to have on record, on file, property management and emergency contacts. There are also restrictions about when transportation can occur and how the food service is performed and maintenance requirements. And as I mentioned, we do and we'll continue to do required inspections, even though we're reducing the number. Next. In terms of the applications, we've required a written management plan, security plan, emergency evacuation plan, neighborhood outreach plan. And, you know, we have looked to at leases. And then the term limit was previously 1 year. This change with one additional renewal period would allow the use for 2 years. Okay. In terms of the findings, the findings are it's basically the same as the findings we made before. It helps us achieve a balance of land uses to provide a range of housing and jobs, libraries and educational recreation facilities. Obviously, you know, we're trying to provide an outlet where we have very limited housing that would have limited effects on the community. We're also, like I mentioned, allowing for commercial areas that might not be fully utilized to incorporate new housing opportunities. We're preserving the diverse economy, allowing for employee housing. I should say not just ag housing, but it could be also used by, you know, school system or other, you know, the hospital if they need to. And the other thing to mention is that it allows for homeless or interim housing, and it has been used quite a bit because of the pandemic. It will encourage a production of housing that meets the needs of many essential workers in our community. Okay, next. And this, you know, project will facilitate, again, housing and economic development provisions in the general plan, new investment in hotels that may have otherwise, you know, further decayed and not been used, address the emergency housing needs of not only our workers, but homeless and other displaced residents. And it ensures compatibility with the neighboring properties because we do have many performance standards that are placed upon these uses. Next slide. It won't create an isolated district because, you know, essentially the only difference between who's staying there and a transitional person or a tourist is how long they stay. It will be, they stay beyond the 28-day limit. And obviously this is an urbanized area where we're already, it's fully developed with utilities, roads, and services. Okay, move forward. From a CEQA perspective, this is exempt with, it's CEQA exempt in terms of it doesn't result in any significant impacts because obviously more or less the same use remains and it involves a minor alteration to the zoning code. You know, it helps with, as I mentioned, it'd be categorically exempt as well under section 15061B3 in that it also allows for the temporary use of a hotel or motel for employee or interim housing. And so our recommendation to the Planning Commission is to recommend to the City Council that the project is found categorically exempt from CEQA and that they introduce and adopt the accompanying ordinance amending the temporary use of land section by allowing for the additional renewal of the TULIP, as we call them, and for employer interim housing in existing properties developed as a hotel or motel. And that concludes my presentation.
Are there any questions from the commissioners to Ms. Hunter about this ID 20-582? Commissioner Donahue? Dennis, you're muted.
Yeah. Is 2 years the maximum opportunity for renewal? Is there, I mean, I would think this, just out of curiosity, I mean, I'm fine with the recommendation. Is it possible that it could be extended, or is that, and that just simply can be taken up at that time, or is that not allowed for, I guess, for lack of a better phrase?
Yeah, since this is a temporary use of land permit, it's really supposed to be for a temporary use, so we really don't like to extend it. Even 2 years is kind of on the outside edge of where we feel comfortable, but we are working on a permanent solution that would actually allow the hotels to get a conditional use permit that would allow them to continue beyond the 2 years.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Gonzalez? Any questions for Ms. Hunter?
Yes, thank you. And thanks for the presentation. It was really helpful. I'm wondering, just in terms of quality of housing for employees, how many employees are in one motel room and how many people have to share a bathroom?
It depends. Usually it's 2 to 4. And there's always a bathroom in there. Some of that is regulated actually through the county requirements.
Okay, great. And then just, I encouraged to hear that there's a more permanent solution in the works, but just wondering what that looks like, or what are you hoping to have in place to avoid having to do another extension?
Yeah, so we had actually been working with the stakeholder group to craft the ordinance, which would actually amend the extended stay provisions that would allow for extended stay for up to a 10-month period of time with a conditional use permit. And those would be, they could keep going for years and years because they run with the property, but the extension would be a 10-month period of time. And the reason why we even thought about trying to package these together really quickly and just getting it done like right away. But the problem is because many of the hotel motels that are using these tulips are in the airport overlay, we actually have to go through this additional county process of going to the airport land use commission. And they have also been impacted by the pandemic and haven't been meeting as often. So to give us additional time, we felt like we needed to push this through so that the hotel motel owners had some assurances that they could extend, because now they're making the contracts with the labor contractor. So we are confident that we will be able to get it done, and it will also give them time to apply for and get a conditional use permit before a year runs out. Because they'll probably be occupied in March. So we anticipate that this will extend to March of 2022, which will give us plenty of time to make the change and even have the hotel motel owners do what they need to get a conditional use permit. And we want to keep them on a short leash too, because we don't want it to be, you know, this temporary use of land. We really want to legalize it in this way.
Thank you.
Commissioner Monzo? Any questions for Ms. Hunter?
I've been asked, so thank you. Asked and answered.
Okay. Commissioner Knorr, any questions?
No, I've been answered. Thank you.
And I have no questions for Ms. Hunter. Do we have a motion on this item?
Time for public comment. If there are any members attending this meeting that would like to make a public comment on this item, if you can use the raise hand feature. Okay.
Okay, so what we're doing is we're looking for a motion on the zoning code amendment 2020-02, which is the ordinance to permit one renewal of temporary use of land permit. Anyone like to make a motion?
Sure, I'll make a motion to approve a resolution recommending the City Council adopt the ordinance amending the zoning code to permit it's 2 year renewal, not 1 year renewal. Is that correct? Of the temporary use of the land permit for the
It's 1 year renewal because they already can operate for 1 year. Yep.
Gotcha. Okay, great. Thank you.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay. With the motion by Commissioner Knorr and a second by Commissioner Donahue, we'll take a roll call vote. But first, I'd like to restate the what we're voting on here. It's the Zoning Code Amendment 20-002, ordinance to permit one renewal of a temporary use of land permit for temporary employee and interim housing and existing properties developed as hotels and motels. Okay, roll call vote, please.
Commissioner Donahue?
Yes.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Yes.
Commissioner Monzo?
Aye.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yes.
Chairperson Meeks?
Yes. So with that vote, we have the Planning Commission's action on this item is a recommendation to the City Council in support of Zoning Code Amendment 2020-002, an ordinance to permit one renewal of a temporary use of land permit for temporary employee and interim housing and existing properties developed as a hotel or motel. The staff will schedule the matter for the City Council's consideration, at which time a final decision will be made. Thank you. Moving on. ID 20-585, conditional use permit 20-20-008, request to establish and operate an employee housing medium project with a maximum of 10 employees within an existing 2,038 square foot single family detached dwelling unit with a two space 67% parking reduction located at 13464 Pierce Street. The residential low density R-L-5.5 zoning district. And who is going to present this for us?
Chairperson Meek and Commissioners. This is conditional use permit 2020-008, which is a request to establish and operate an employee housing medium project with maximum 10 employees within an existing single family dwelling unit with a parking reduction located at 13464 Pierce Street. In the residential low density zoning district. The applicant for the project is Marine Rock Planning LLC. The property owner is JR Harvesting. As stated, the facility is located at 13464 Pierce Street. It would be for proposed for a maximum of 10 employees, be seasonal employees for reside from 8 to 9 months per year. It is a existing one-story single-family detached dwelling unit with a one-car garage, pretty close to two, but it's pretty much right now, technically it's a one-car garage and a three-bedroom home. And that's one of the reasons why they have the parking reduction, they need three parking spaces. There is no proposed increase in the existing floor area. There is a mistake in the background, actually, it is zoned RL5.5 of residential low density. And residential uses are adjacent to the subject property. On November the 5th, 2019, the Salinas City Council adopted ordinance number 2623, which amended zoning code sections 37-10.290, 37-10.300, 37-10.330, and so other sections of chapter 37 to clarify small project employee housing in both the residential low and residential medium zoning districts, subject to approval of a conditional use permit. This would allow for the expansion of employee housing while preserving neighborhood character. The ordinance was adopted by the City Council in response to issues that were raised by both the Salinas plan and the Farm Worker Housing Study and Action Plan of the Salinas Valley and Mojaro Valley, stressing the need for an immediate solution to provide safe, decent housing for both employee and emergency housing. The zoning code, as stated earlier, requires a minimum of 3 off-street parking spaces. None are allowed in either the front or corner side yard. And the site is, per the map here, is the project site is located on the southwest corner of Swanner Avenue and Pierce Street. There is, as stated earlier, one space garage on site. It requires a two space, 67% parking reduction, which requires, since it's above 30%, requires consideration by the Planning Commission. Staff believes that it's mitigated by providing transportation because there'll be a pickup, the transportation. transportation plan that was dated on July 30th, 2020. The map shows the project site and the location of the pickup and drop-off site, which is MST, Salinas Transit Stop 49. It's located approximately 1,000 feet to the southeast of the subject property. Workers would pick up a bus from a JRR staying the property owner and be transported to their work site and then transported back to the transit stop after work, where they would walk back to the employee housing medium use. This would allow employees living on site to commute without the need for an on-site automobile, and the CUP would not allow for any bus drop-off or pickups to be allowed on site. Concerning the parking reduction, the proposed use is limited to employee housing medium project only and would not be allowed to be converted to another use which require greater parking requirement than the three that would be required as part of the employee housing use. The requirement of the zoning code does require the facility to register with the employee housing medium project with the city of Salinas with the housing and provide the following: that any housing HCD, California Housing Community Development approvals pursuant to the California Health and Safety Code, emergency contact information, contact for property maintenance, and the transportation plan, which they have already provided. And the registration would require contacts for emergency contact information, contacts for property management, and the status of emergency contacts. Staff originally scheduled this for October the 7th, 2020, and mailed out public notices on September the 18th. Staff received many comments on this application, therefore continued it. This, along with two other related applications, to conditional use permit 2020-09 and 2020-010, and they have been stated continued. The Community Development Department has received the comments from Sheila Fawcett, Shauna Bois, Carla Prado, and Amy Thompson and Joan Bennett, which are nearby property owners, indicating concerns with traffic, lack of adequate parking, trash, overcrowding, alcohol use, on-site partying, and the lack of the compatibility of the higher density agricultural housing with adjacent single family residential neighborhoods. The comments from those individuals were included as part of the Planning Commission staff packet. The applicant has provided a housing handbook, which is Exhibit F of the proposed conditional use permit approval document, which has basic rules concerning housing inspections, drugs and alcohol, respect and bullying, parties, gatherings, loud music, visitors, transportation, emergency contact, and emergency contact numbers. As stated, the housing handbook is requires a condition of approval, which is Exhibit F, conditional use permit. Also, a condition in the CUP does not allow for the storage and consumption of alcohol on site, which is prohibited. Staff believes that the conditional use permit can be found categorically exempt from the California Environmental Quality Act per Section 15301, since it is an existing facility. This is a picture of the site. It says it's on the southwest corner of Pierce Street and Warner Avenue. And public notice was published in the Herald on December 23rd, and notice was sent to property owners posted on the ground December 21st. Staff recommended a motion to approve the project, finding the project exempt from CEQA and pursuant to a Class 1 capital exemption, and approved conditional use permit 2020-008. That finishes my presentation. Are there any questions from the commissioners at this time?
Okay, that was the last of your presentation. Are there any questions from commissioners to Mr. Wiles regarding this presentation? Mr. Donahue?
Nothing at the moment.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Yes. I'm wondering, you know, I understand the motel hotel situation is temporary and that there's a larger fix that the city is working on. To what extent is this use of single family units a temporary or more permanent fix to the housing crisis?
This is permanent. It's as long as it's once it's properly established, unless ceases operation for a continuous period of 6 months or more. So it is permanent unless they cease operation for more than six months.
One of the concerns that I had, and I imagine other commissioners have, is around, you know, quality of housing and how many people are being expected to live in one single family unit. This one, it looks like it's 10. In the other two, it's more. And I believe in this one, there are two bathrooms for 10 people. So that's 5 people per bathroom. I tried to find, you know, what's considered adequate housing in terms of the ratio of people to bathrooms. And I think 5 is cutting it pretty close, or maybe considered semi-inadequate. And then I noticed in some of the comments from neighbors, there was the concern around human excrement. And we know nobody wants to defecate in public. That happens when you don't have access to adequate facilities. And so I'm wondering how that would be addressed, and to what extent are there, sorry, I'm piling on a bunch of questions here. How many other projects like this are there throughout the city? How common is this? And is this a practice that would be continued? And if so, how do we protect workers and make sure that employers are providing adequate housing for them?
Well, this is the first of 3 such projects that are proposed. The other two are also being presented. There is a housing handbook which covers the conduct of employees, housing inspection, drugs and alcohol, respect, bullying, and one of the things is party gatherings without music. Party gatherings are not allowed indoors or outdoors at any time, and loud music or disturbance will not be tolerated, and means of disciplinary action taken. This comes from the applicant, that they will discipline any individual that breaks the housing rules stated in the housing handbook. That's Exhibit F, proposed Exhibit F, and finish on this permit.
Those rules and regulations seem to restrict the workers' freedom of movement. Seems like a pretty challenging quality of life to work all day and not be allowed to have a party in your home or celebrate we would definitely allow for other families across and other people across the residents across the city to have celebrations, relax, play music, et cetera. But I'm not hearing, you know, where are the regulations that would actually protect these workers from negative conditions?
Yeah, they would have to, condition number 9, they would have to register with the city of Salinas, and also one of those is any applicable regulations required by the HCD, which is California Housing and Community Development, per the Health and Safety Code. Pretty much that they would have to comply with state and any applicable city regulations concerning employer housing.
Thank you.
Commissioner Manzo.
May I answer one question, if you don't mind? There was a question about, I think some standards. There are standards of what the dwelling requirements need to be. And we did look at some, basic standards that HUD or other entities may require. And so it does require, and these are also consistent with the Employee Housing Act, since this is for employee housing, that there's at least full two bathrooms per dwelling unit, that there's at least 50 square feet per occupant in the sleeping areas, and that there is a full kitchen, which includes cooking apparatus and a refrigerator. So there are some requirements that we did kind of look at a variety of different, I think, regulations. The current way land use law works is that this use is allowed for up to six people. And that's why it's actually a by right use if you have six or fewer people in a house. This city council amended the zoning code to allow between 6 and 14 as a medium housing project if they went through a conditional use permit and provided additional things to I think be compatible with the neighborhood and not cause issues. So there are, we came up with conditions that we felt balance that, but there are other conditions that Planning Commission can consider in looking at some of the findings that are made with the conditional use permit process. But we did look at habitability requirements when we came up with the basic standards that they'd have to meet.
Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Monzo, questions?
Yes, I have a question that's similar, but it's the other side of the coin of the question that Commissioner Gonzalez asked, which I agree with the piece. When I saw the list of things that they can't do, I was thinking of, you know, when you go to an Airbnb and I mean, it's for a weekend, right? And so you have to respect those rules and all that, but this is a place where people are going to be leaving for 8 to 8 months, 8 to 9 months. So it feels a little restrictive in that sense. I get the sense of having to be respectful, but yeah, just keeping that in mind. My question was around, it was connected to the previous question that was asked around long-term solutions, because I know that some of the hesitation or the concerns from community members is that, you know, H-2A workers, there's housing for H-2A workers, which is the case here, right? Which is solving some of the parking issues that some of the residents named. And my aunt lives a street over, so I know it's impossible to find parking there. So that solves that issue. But I guess my question is around, you know, what are the long-term solutions that we're even considering or exploring as we think about more adequate housing for farm workers that are currently living in the city, right? Because this is solving the H-2A piece or trying to find a solution to that. But I guess I'm trying to think about, because one of the concerns that I hear in the community is the displacement of workers in the community because of the H-2A workers, right? And so can you share any of the solutions that you're starting to consider as part of that long-term? And I know that housing crisis isn't just in Salinas, it's everywhere, right? But it would be helpful to think about.
Do you mind if I answer that?
Okay.
Just because I was part of the dialogue. So the one thing we didn't do and we didn't allow is this is not allowed in multifamily buildings, because we were actually very concerned that multifamily buildings, which are many of our permanent farm worker housing families are living with, would be purchased and they would be displaced. So this was kind of a relief valve to prohibit that. And because of the conditional use process, it would notify the neighbors, it would allow for conditions to be placed upon it and to limit displacement. So we very much were thinking about displacement as when we came up with this kind of solution. Secondly, I think City Council expressed this, is that they'd much rather see it in the hotel motels than even in the residential neighborhoods. So that's why we are, you know, proceeding with kind of a permanent fix to that. So we have been actually discouraging the labor contractors from buying houses and doing this. And by virtue of requiring it to be a conditional use permit process, we actually had some of the labor contractors actually decide that they didn't want to proceed further because it wouldn't be necessarily an easy thing to do. And so they actually are looking at doing other forms of housing. And we're now starting to see labor contractors produce housing, as we see that one project, that large project being built on Davis Road, with the city is really supportive of the concept of the ag employee housing being built on the outskirts. And then for the permanent farm worker housing, we have the action plan and also the Salinas plan that call for the city to really focus on the construction of affordable housing. So we're really focused on how we can facilitate affordable housing production and looking at housing policies globally and working with partners to see how we can tap into funding like the Joe Serna Fund to build affordable housing. So we're really, you know, we're hoping, we actually just put out an RFP for Division Street, and we're hoping to see housing projects like that that would be affordable for our families, including our permanent farm worker house families. So those are kind of the things we're thinking about. And the genesis of this ordinance was to actually stop it from being, you know, I think the council was very concerned when a labor contractor went to buy a apartment complex in Soledad and was going to displace 29 families. So that's prohibited right now in the city of Salinas.
And so just to understand, and I think Mr. Wells mentioned it a little bit, but just to clarify, this is the first time that something like this comes to the Planning Commission and that will go to council, is that right? And so if it doesn't work out, like, you know, if this is like a trial, if it doesn't work out, can you revoke the conditional use permit? Or I guess I'm trying to figure out if we're setting a precedent that then we can't walk back later. No,
so it won't go to City Council because the unless it's appealed, unless, you know, depending on, you know, whether the applicant or neighborhood appeals it. So it would stop with you. I think the nice thing and the reason why we did a conditional use permit is each individual property can be looked at as a unique experience and considered, you know, what the impacts are. Do they have a good plan for how they're going to manage their housing in a way that is compatible with the residential neighborhood? And we can revoke a conditional use. There is a process to revoke a conditional use permit if they're not meeting the conditions that are spelled out in that attachment that you received as part of your packet. And that would come back to the Planning Commission, and they have, of course, their due diligence process. But it does run with the land, and so long as they're, you know, adhering to the conditions, it can continue.
Okay, that's it.
Mr. Noor, questions?
Yeah.
Or comments?
If I'm curious if the applicant considered doing an ADU or a JADU instead of trying to go this route of the employee housing to get additional bedroom and facilities to provide more space for the proposed residents.
I think they probably just wanted, as part of the CUP process or employer housing medium, I think they wanted to stick with this route. Marine Ruck, the applicant, is really one of the attendees, but the applicant pretty much wanted to go through the process as approved by the original ordinance for employee housing medium to allow for up to, I think, 14 is the maximum allowed. That's the 2623 ordinance.
Yeah. I guess the concern would be typical family, saying, you know, married couple with, you know, two kids per bedroom, that's six, right? That gets you to the kind of standard here. We're almost doubling that to 10. Seems a very intensification. And when the city council, my understanding, when the city council looked at this, it was based on, you know, compatible neighborhood considerations. And this being an RL district for low density residential, we're kind of flipping it on its head and making this multifamily in a way where maybe this would be more compatible for an RM or RH type of zone neighborhood, where you have a higher density and type of intensification, and you're a little closer to uses. I know we are close to Lowe's, maybe a couple blocks away, but I don't know if there was any discussions on that.
Well, as far as I know, that the city council adopted it, you know, to help provide a solution to farm worker housing and immediate need for it, and they determined that residential low, the RL, the RM residential medium districts for the immediate need were appropriate, and primarily for single family residences such as.
And Tom, maybe I could respond to this too, because I do know that we did think about this, and there are no occupancy restrictions in a single family property. And what we are seeing, which is much more common, is we're seeing homeowners who are renting rooms to families, multiple families. So we are actually seeing overcrowding, and there's not regulation that can be imposed upon that. This type of housing, fortunately employee housing, we would actually have some ability to impose conditions and look at some of those concerns, because it would require conditional use permit. And so that's, I think, went into some of the thinking of city council, is that it's already happening, unfortunately, through kind of this rental situation, but this would be a way of somehow managing it. And I know that I don't know if you all remember the ones that may have been in the planning commission in 2019 when you weighed in on this. I think that was maybe a consideration that was also discussed at the planning commission.
I'm not a property manager, but I've heard there's a kind of a guideline rule about it's two occupants per unit plus one guest per bedroom. That's kind of the rule. So it seems like we're stretching it there. I'm trying. It's like the Cal RHA law. I'm sorry. I'm trying to remember that, but it seemed like there was an occupancy guideline set by the state of California, especially when it comes to rental properties.
I'm not aware of any occupancy regulations in terms of the building code or RHA. I know that the council approved for a maximum of 14 residents, or 14 employees. And so, you know, this one's under that maximum allowed 14.
Yeah, there's no occupancy standards in land use regulations. The occupancy standards that you may be referring to are for subsidized housing, when government is subsidizing.
You're saying it's more applicable from the Department of Fair Housing and Employment?
Yeah, well, it's more applicable for, you know, like HUD has, like your Section 8 vouchers. There are certain requirements for occupancy standards, but really there are no occupancy standards in city regulations.
Okay.
There's nothing we can, in other words, there's nothing we can impose. This is actually, this ordinance is actually highly unique, because we don't really have too many things in the zoning code with occupancy standards. This is one of the few things that we do have.
Thank you.
Hey, I have a few questions. First question is, how far is it from the residence to the JR harvesting place where the bus will pick them up?
Well, from the, it's around 1,000 feet for the bus pickup area. It's 1,000 feet, which is on San Juan Grade Road, Northridge Way. And then they go to JR Harvesting, which is at 20300 Spence Road in Monterey County, I think south of the city. And then they try to transport it back to the transit stop. So they're about 1,000 feet away from the pickup spot.
Thank you. My second question is, you spoke about a housing handbook. Is this going to be, or has it been supplied to the property owners who live around this proposed housing unit?
Not necessarily given to the property owners per se or adjacent, but it's part of the CUP, which is part of the public record, Exhibit F. And so that's part of the draft CUP approval document.
So what we're saying is the property owners who live around this area wouldn't necessarily know what the rules are.
Not unless they have the copy of the conditional use permit, but the Exhibit F, the housing handbook, would be a required condition of approval. Condition of the exhibit, just as any other part of the document. And would need to be complied with by the applicant or the successor in interest of the subject property.
They are required to post the emergency contact information for the neighbors to be able to contact and register with the city. So if we got complaints, which we often, we do get complaints, the city would be able to follow up directly.
Yeah, emergency contacts will be posted in each housing unit in case of an emergency.
Okay, my third question is, will the employees be charged by the DNR harvesting to live in these residential units?
As far as required to live in this area, or?
Yeah, is the employer going to charge the employees to live there?
I'm not aware of that.
Generally, this is regulated by the H-2A requirements. As part of the visa, you have to provide housing. They are able to charge a nominal amount, but it's very small amount. I think it's like something like $50 a week or something like that. So it's a nominal amount. We could find that out, but generally they don't charge.
Okay, because I was gonna say $50 a week per occupant, there's 14 occupants. That's a fair sum of money that surpasses the average rental in the city of Salinas.
Yeah, I mean, we could ask for the applicant's representative if she knows, but generally they do not charge.
Okay.
Because it's pretty restricted.
We do have the applicant attending if you'd like to take the statement.
Before we get to the applicant, I did one more question. If you could, Megan or staff could clarify the parking reduction. They're not proposing to convert the garage, are they, to a habitable space and no. Just have the driveway? It's going to be maintain the driveway and the parking stalls, right?
Technically it's a one-car garage. It's close to a two-car garage, but it's a one-car garage and they're not going to do anything to the garage. But technically they only have one space garage. And so they have to have a two car parking reduction as a part of the CUP. But they're not proposing to get rid of the garage or the driveway this time.
Okay, great, thank you.
Any additional questions?
One last question, is open space based on number of bedrooms or based on zoning?
Based on zoning, number of units, so usually it's like 1,000 square feet per unit.
per dwelling.
When you say unit, it's not based on bedrooms, it's just based on, so like a single family home is 1,000 square feet of open space. It's not based on number of bedrooms in that residential unit. Say like if I'm doing single family, I need a 3-bedroom unit has 500 square feet, 4-bedroom is 750 square feet.
It's per dwelling unit.
Yeah. Okay. If there are no further questions, Planning Secretary, are there any comments from the public regarding this item?
Yes, there is one that was received January 5th, 2021, and it reads, City of Salinas, public opinion. This note is to object to the ag housing located in 13464 Pier Street. This is a single family home residential area. These ag men shouldn't be placed in our neighborhood. These men had been in the house in the past and they never respect the rules from the city. City is called at the moment, but nobody responds. One of the most scary things is that they are outside the property quite often when kids walk by. Remember, there is a school in this area and many kids are around. You don't know what kind of people you are bringing into this family area, and you are not thinking on these kids that walk daily through this house. This men drink and leave bottles outside, music, etc. Some kids had complaint of being scared due to this people keep staring at them. Just think of it or your own. I hope nothing ever happens to none of these kids or any adult. Let's remark that the city of Salinas is okaying these men to live in a family residential area. Also, a couple of my neighbors have a second home close by. They had mentioned that if this ag house passes, they will do their second residence as an ag house as well. So we can't afford to have all of this residential convert to ag houses. Since our neighborhood is already overcrowded as it is, I think the ag people should be placed in the outskirts of Salinas in trailers or wherever, but not in this neighborhood. The owner of this house has lots of money and he can very well bring this ag business somewhere else. I thank you and I hope you take serious consideration on my petition since there is many kids around this area. Thank you. And that was the only public comment received for this item, except for the ones that were already made part of the record.
Okay, are there any questions or comments from the commissioners to Mr. Wild?
Thanks, Jim.
Commissioner Donahue.
Hey, Chair Meeks, you do have public comment with folks having their hand raised. So we need to deal with those also.
Okay, I can't see those on my screen, so I don't know. But please go ahead.
We have Josue Rodriguez. I will unmute your microphone and you will be provided with 2-minute time limit to provide public comment.
Hello, my name's Flor Rodriguez. So I'm actually one of the owners of JR Harvesting. I just took on our employee housing projects starting in 2019. So I'd like to address some of the questions and concerns. As far as quality of life, I know Commissioner Gonzalez was concerned about that. So the restrictions on parties and that type of thing, it's been set due to COVID. We don't want any visitors coming into the house or them going and visiting other people. They are free to roam, you know, about their neighborhoods and have that type of thing inside amongst their own households. The other thing we do, because the H-2A visa itself is a privilege that they get to come and work out here. We do ask them to be model citizens and to we hold them a little bit to a higher standard than the rest of the neighbors there, just for the same reason. We want them to be included as part of the neighborhood. And I know there is a lot of concern about, you know, X amount of people, especially men living in those neighborhoods. I just got involved with this project. So we do have the ability. We're daily going, checking on the property, making sure it's staying clean. We have put our numbers out there before to where if any neighbors have concerns, we come out and we address them. So we are very involved with them. We're very proactive with the workers. And the other thing, as far as charging, we do not charge at all. We provide the free housing. And the reason we're looking to use this for now is we have a property out on Fez Road where We are building a housing project where all of our employees will just be there. And we're going with pre-manufactured homes. The reason I prefer that over motels is if you have your H-2A worker somewhere where there's a kitchen, then you provide transportation to do grocery shopping. And then they cook what they like, what they're comfortable with, where motels, you provide three meals a day. There's no kitchenettes where they can cook for themselves. So then sometimes they don't like the food. Sometimes, you know, it can get repetitive for them. So this way they have a little more freedom to do what they're comfortable with. We did have some problems in the past. Our staffing before was a little different in the way they carried the housing. Since I am one of the owners, I'm personally involved with the project. So as far as them following rules and, you know, their quality of life, that's something that I'm involved in every day now. So I'm just, you know, if there's any other questions or anything, I'd be more than happy to answer. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Rodriguez. Are there any comments from the public?
Yes, thank you so much. From the public. Sorry, I had a question. I had a question for Mr. Rodriguez.
Mr. Rodriguez, are you still on the line?
Yes.
Hi, thank you. Just considering the concern from neighbors around parking, how common is it for H-2A workers to have their own vehicles? Will there be additional vehicles?
So typically we try not to have them have vehicles for the same reason. In the past, what they would get together maybe as a household and purchase one or two vehicles, because before the pandemic, they would take weekends, ask for days off to go visit their families. Most of them are from across the border. And that's something that in normal times we like to let them do, because you're away from your family, you know, 6 to 8 months, and it gets very difficult. So that's something that they were doing in the past, and just makes it easier for them and cheaper. They, you know, they purchase a car as a group, they go and see their families and come back, where if they don't have them, then they're paying for, you know, buses or airplanes, and it gets expensive for them. As far as the transportation for Mexico here, we provide that. And then when they don't have vehicles, we provide transportation for grocery shopping. We have a safety team that takes them to doctor's appointments or any other needs that they need for transportation. So they have purchased vehicles before and used them. And again, before I came on, it was starting to get to where they were getting 4 or 5 vehicles. This year we changed it. This particular house on Pierce had one vehicle this last year, and that's strictly what it was used for, grocery shopping. And when they did ask for, the way we did trips to go visit families was a lot more regulated this year. We had them go take COVID tests. We would test them again upon return. So they did maybe 2 trips out of the whole season to see their families. So vehicles is something nice for them to have, but it's not something that we need. You know, it's not, if we can't have the vehicles, we're okay with that, because we're equipped to meet their transportation needs.
Sounds like up to 2 vehicles per house would be fine. It wouldn't impact the parking since there is a driveway.
Yeah, and that's all dependent on. For us, you know, that's all dependent on what the city allows us to allow them. That would be perfectly fine. And since I'm on here, one more thing I'd like to address. It was a question you had about bathrooms. So we go by, the State Department has certain rules. I think their regulation was one full bathroom for every 10 people. And that's where they go. So by what you're saying, 5 for 1, I mean, it's still not quite like your typical home, but I think it is a little better than what the state allows.
Thank you.
Then we have another comment from Maureen Buck. Go ahead, Maureen.
Hello? Well, thank you for unmuting me. I am the applicant and I do appreciate it. There's a few things that I can resolve. First, this is H2A housing and it's temporary H2A housing. Our housing was supposed to go up in Spence Road for H2A workers. Unfortunately, between COVID and the wildfires, we didn't get there. The guys on Davis Road and Rossi Road got there long before we did. So we are attempting to work that out on Spence Road for the H2A workers. It is true. In 2018, we had quite a few letters written, and you can see those letters that are in the file in 2018. That's no longer the case. The people who were involved with that are gone. Josh is running the program. It is very tightly run. H2A workers, as you know, go through a very tight security check with Homeland Security. They don't just come into the country. They go through a security check and, they go through a security check and they go also through interviews with Homeland Security. So they don't just come here and nobody knows who they are. Homeland Security, the State Department, and many other people, ICE and others, know exactly who they are and where they are. They're trapped. So that is something that all of these applications have that are familiar. They are indeed H2A workers, not just employees. They're all H2A workers. There are 10 people per house. They're not all put in bedrooms. The living room under H2A working can be converted. Each individual has to have 50 square feet or more per person for personal space. Each and every one of these units has kitchen, a full kitchen, bath, and usually a barbecue outside. With regard—
Thank you, 2 minutes is up.
Pardon me?
I had one question for Mr. Rodriguez, if he's still available. Okay, apparently not. In that case, are there any other comments from the public?
Mr. Rodriguez, hold on.
A quick question was, the workers living in this housing, are they required to vacate when the growing season's over?
Correct. We actually transport them back to the border ourselves. Some of them will continue to work with us in the Yuma season where they are right now, actually. And then the H2A program allows you to renew your permit for 3 years and then you have to sit out a season. So the ones that will not be returning, they have to turn in their passport and their visa and exit so that they can qualify for the next season where they will be eligible to come back.
Thank you. Planning Secretary, any other comments from the public?
I wanted to note that Maureen Ruck, who is speaking, is actually Josue's representative. So she might be equipped to answer the land use, any land use questions, since she's, you know, the land use expert for Mr. Rodriguez. So it would be probably beneficial, Myra, if you let her also.
Megan, first let's ask commissioners if they have any land use questions.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any of the commissioners, you have any questions relating to land use?
Yeah, if you could clarify on this conditional use, it was stated the H2A is a temporary housing. So is this conditional use permit also temporary in terms of this is like just like what we just did for the hotel where it's a 1 year CUP, or is this permanent, and that where when you say temporary housing, that means that the occupants staying there are just temporary on a rotational basis.
CUP itself is, there is no expiration date for the CUP. That once it's properly established, unless the subject employee housing medium project use ceases operation for a continuous period of 6 months or more, the CUP is a permanent. Now, as far as workers, that's a different story.
So the H-2A temporary housing really is just referring to the workers there. This is just temporary seasonal housing. That is that correct? Is that
well, for the CUP, the workers may have, you know, it sounds like they're temporary seasonal workers, but the CUP itself is, there is no expiration date unless, as per that, there is cease operation 6 months or more.
Maybe I could comment briefly on that, Commissioner Noor. This is a little different from the zoning code amendment that we just heard earlier today. This is a conditional use permit. Permit stays in effect forever so long as the conditions are complied with. In this particular case, they're seasonal. Tom mentioned, I think it's like 8-9 months out of the year. And if there's a 3-month lapse, no problem. If there's a 9-month lapse, no problem. If it's more than a 6-month lapse, there is a problem. Sorry, I got my numbers mixed up. So yes, year after year after year, this conditional use permit will stay in effect so long as the gap does not exceed the 6 months.
Okay. Now I'll ask just to be polite, Ms. Warwick, are there any other comments you'd like to make? I'll give you a little additional time. Please unmute your mic. Thank you. Additional comments?
Hi, I was locked out. I'm back.
Okay. I know.
I've had that problem before.
Oh, well.
So I was asking, I gave you some additional time if you want to make other comments. Any commissioners have additional comments for Ms. Warwick? Okay. Hearing none, thank you, Ms. Warwick. Okay, would any of the commissioners like to make a motion? And
I guess Chair Meeks, I'm really struggling with this. I certainly recognize the need for, you know, the farm working housing. I think projects like what we did, we just discussed previously for the temporary hotel conversion are great solutions. However, putting in temporary HVA housing in a residential, especially in RL, very low residential zone neighborhood, I'm having difficulty kind of getting comfortable with the idea of it being compatible. Mm-hmm. And I'm not caught up in terms of the parking or the, and actually I've kind of bothered a little about by all the restrictions imposed by the occupants, because I like feel like it's a little restrictive and you're kind of trying to dictate how people should live their life. I'm more concerned about just the densification of it. And it seems like we're coming in and putting in something that is RH type of density in an RL district. And it's kind of like this leapfrog zoning and just creating a large multifamily project surrounded by single family homes. But with that being said, on the flip side, I look at it, I'm like, well, if they went and did an ADU or the JADU, they could potentially get back up to those numbers. So, you know, it's kind of like, you know, how do we dice this so that it's both compatible to the existing neighbors and it fulfills a housing need in our community. So that's just kind of just my thoughts right now and where I'm at. And I'm still kind of balancing, you know, what's the appropriate direction in my mind.
I agree.
And I want to just let the commission know you have to be somewhat careful on this, because remember, this is a use that is permitted, that was adopted by city council to allow this up to a certain point. And the conditional use permit is really to regulate, to nail down what about this project you feel is insufficient in terms of conditions, and to look at what kind of conditions could make it compatible with the community. Because the use in itself, you know, it's almost saying like, well, you know, I don't think multifamily should be built here after a zone change occurs in an area that is, you know, evolving. You can't really restrict what is somewhat allowed unless the current configuration is you can't make the findings that it's the conditions meet it. But you know what I'm saying? You can't really say, well, that number doesn't work, because what the zoning code says is that it can work if the conditions are correct.
John, I just want to, if I could just jump in. And as I told you earlier, I have a hard stop, so I may or may not be able to vote, but to Megan's point, and I think maybe to address what Matt said, if I understood all this correctly, since this technically stops with the Planning Commission subject to appeal, basically the council has already made the decision, and the real conversation here is staff recommendations on conditions meeting the criteria, because you know, if you were to set this situation aside and it was just a house, if I recall, and I don't want this to be a distracting comment, technically somebody could buy a house. And I remember when I first took office many years ago, and I was kind of startled because you have similar issues, you know, and you could have a dozen people in the house, and it, according to the state, it was fine. So we've been provided a framework and simply been asked to comment on the staff's recommendations on conditions meet their direction, that the previous council has considered all this. And then I think the other thing I would say, without, you know, I mean, I'm having been in the ag community, I'm familiar with JR, but I don't know all the particulars. I think it's important to recognize that everybody who does H2A housing is not a large grower shipper. It could be a smaller mid-sized player. And if it seems to me that the city has tried to do a good job of, you know, frankly, discouraging this, you know, because I think you do want to preserve the characters of neighborhoods. But on the other hand, recognizing you've got a shortage, you want as many entities as possible to try and help the cause. And sometimes everybody is not going to be, you know, have the same resources as, let's say, a Tanimir and Annal, but they're trying to solve a problem that everyone agrees needs to be solved. But fundamentally, if I understand it, our role here is simply to say your recommendation on conditions either are or are not sufficient. Is that correct? So I just wanted to make sure I understood it, and then that would be my comment. And then, like I say, regrettably, I have to leave for a call in a few moments, so I may or may not be able to hang in for the vote. But you still have a quorum. So, but I wanted to make sure I understood it.
Hey, thank you, Commissioner Donahue.
Okay, thank you.
If I can make a quick comment and continuing the clarification, because
Commissioner Monzo, please.
Struggling with was the occupancy level, right? Of, you know, having 10 folks. I know we have another two with 14 coming up. But if you say that that's actually not up for question, right, that's already been established, then is the question only whether or not we feel that the emergency numbers, that the restriction in terms of like how you solve issues, the quality of the housing, that's what's up for question then, those pieces. Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other questions or comments from the commissioners?
I just quickly wanted to acknowledge the bigger context and appreciation for one, this effort to avoid displacing multifamily units. And wanted to just address the parking again, and I don't know if the condition can be placed that there be a limit of two cars for the house, or, you know, a limit to the number of parking that's already provided for that unit. I don't know if that's already included, but and then just to acknowledge that it sounds like the previous issues that homeowners were responding to, the company is trying to address that through the hiring of Mr. Rodriguez as somebody who can really ensure that there's adequate oversight and care for the unit.
Thank you. As I understand it, when it comes to parking on the street is public parking. You can put as many vehicles there as you like. If you look at the street where I live, it's people from everywhere park on this street. But secondly, I'll go back and ask the question once more. And if we don't have a motion or a second, we'll ask the city attorney what the procedure is to follow on. So would any of the commissioners like to make a motion?
Chair Meeks, could we get that question answered though? So is that right? That you can restrict the number of cars per the household for the conditional use? Can we just confirm that that's the case?
Well, they only have technically a one space garage. So I don't know if they can, you know, where the parking would be, because technically it's not supposed to be the front or corner side setback.
Let me jump in here, if I may. This is Chris Callahan, please. And to respond to your question, Andre, I don't see that restricting the number of cars is a legally defensible condition that you can incorporate into this conditional use permit. And so I would recommend against doing that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, we still have a quorum. Is there a motion or a second? And if not, Mr. Callahan, how do we proceed on this?
If there is no motion or second, it dies for lack of action and it's going to go to the city council.
Okay, thank you. Do you have a motion and second?
I'll make a motion to recommend for approval, because this isn't a recommendation of council, this is for approval of the CUP as the conditions noted in staff's report.
Is there a second?
I'll second the motion.
Okay, we have a motion by Commissioner Knorr and a second by Commissioner Gonzalez to on item condition permit 2020-006, which is a request to establish and operate an employee housing medium project with a maximum of 10 employees within an existing 2,038 square feet single family unit detached dwelling with a two space 67% parking reduction located at 13464 Pierce Street in the residential low density R-L-5.5 zoning district. Can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Donahue?
He has left us.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Yes.
Commissioner Monzo?
Aye.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yes.
Chairperson Meeks?
No. Okay. The Planning Commission has just approved the request for a conditional use permit, which cannot be issued for 10 days during this 10-day period. Any person having standing to do so under the law who is aggrieved by this action or decision may file an appeal with the Community Development Department located at 55 West Alisal Street. Moving on, how are we doing for time? It's 5:01. Item number two on the agenda. ID 21-001, which is, okay. ID 20-001, conditional use permit 2020-010, request to establish to operate employee housing medium project with a maximum 40 employees within an existing two-story, 2,044 square foot single-family detached dwelling unit with a one space 33% parking reduction located 999 Rock Low Street and residential medium density Williams Road Pacific Plan Overlay R-M-3.6-FP-2 zoning district. Mr. Wiles.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Commissioners. This is a state as request to establish and operate an employee housing medium project, this time for a maximum 14 employees within an existing two-story single family residence with a 67% reduction, parking reduction, located at 1569 Verona Court. The zoning here is actually different. A lot of it is similar to the previous application, same applicant, same property owners. This is located at 1569 Verona Court. This has 14 employees instead of 10. The same, you know, same as far as for this one car garage, three bedroom house, no increase in floor area, existing floor area. The zoning here is different. It's the residential medium 3.6 in the Mountain Valley Pacific Plan overlay, airport overlay. Residential uses are adjacent. Same thing as the ordinance number 2623, which pretty much met several sections of the municipal code to allow for employee housing medium in RL and RM zones, subject to a conditional use permit. Pretty much the same, you know, pretty much expand employee housing or preserve neighborhood character, adopted the issues of Salinas Plan and Farm Work Housing Study and Action Plan for Salinas Valley and Pajaro Valley, and also to provide safe and decent housing for both employee and emergency housing. As stated, it's there is, you know, as far as the same thing as far as the zoning code requirements for parking, it's a transportation plan. And this one, actually, the transit stop is transit stop 41, and actually it's located 2,400 feet away. They would, same thing as with the other, pick up a bus from JR Harvesting, go to the Spencer Road facility, and then come back, be transported, which allows employees to commute without the need for a hotel. No bus drop off or pickup would be allowed on site, similar to the other CUP. The parking reduction could be supported because it's not going to be compared to another use with a greater parking requirement. Same registration requirements, HTD, emergency have contact information, and contact for property maintenance. There is a little bit of difference here. Same notification. We did receive comments from Rosa Gonzalez, including one wave today, a neighbor property owner, indicating concerns with crime and incompatibility of the use with adjacent single-family residential neighborhoods. The same housing handbook requirements apply for this one as per the previous CUP. Staff also feels that this proposed CUP can be found exempt per CEQA from section 15301, existing facilities. The notification was done around the same time, published in the Herald on December 23rd, mailed to all property owners and applicable parties on December 21st and posted on the ground the same day. And so therefore staff recommends that the motion approve a resolution finding the project exempt from the CEQA pursuant to class one category exemption and approve conditional use permit 2020-09. There's questions from the staff presentation. Any questions for commissioners at this time?
Just wondering about the how many rooms did you say for the
one? If could you pull up the floor plan again for us, I think that would be very helpful. It looked like it was a three bedroom house with a loft, and then they on the first floor they were converting like a living room to have two bunk beds as well, maybe.
Yeah, that's
that sound.
So this is a two-story, and pretty much they believe they were going to convert the one post housing plan on the second story as well. This one is an increase. It's 14 rather than 10, which was the previous. Proposed housing plans on the right.
And that's two bathrooms or three?
I actually have
three and a half.
Three and a half. It looks like two and a half. two on the first floor and one half one on the second.
Two and a half.
My first floor.
It was a two and a half, yeah, total?
Yeah.
It's two and a half. Yeah, two and a half.
Half bathroom on the first floor and two on the second.
Yeah, I see it.
And so this, for all three of these properties, the company has purchased them and will continue to use them under this condition, under, if the conditional use permit is approved, this home will continually be used for temporary employee housing.
Correct, as per the terms and conditions of the conditional use permit.
Okay, and managed by Mr. Rodriguez?
Well, the applicant or applicant, you know, or you know, the applicant or successor in interest right now. So if there is any future sale, and if they have to comply with the terms and conditions of the conditions for that as well.
In other words, the applicant is the JR Harvesting Company. The CUP is issued to the applicant.
I think, you know, I'm not sure how appropriate the question is, just the concern about this becoming a permanent practice that is, you know, just hoping that this is not, we're not setting a precedent to where companies will continue the practice of purchasing single family homes for temporary housing, and that instead we're, you know, focused on a on an actual solution. I think this is a better solution than some, but wanting to make sure that it doesn't become a continued practice.
One thing I was going to mention is if the commission at some point sees that this is a problem, you can always make a recommendation to your council member that you were appointed with, or even as a body, to revisit this provision in the zoning code. So, you know, as a planning commission, of course, you don't make legislative decisions that ultimately is city council, but you can always, you know, ask that might be revisited in the future.
Thank you.
Yeah, this one is this is pretty dense. I mean, you got, especially on the second floor, you got that loft area that has two bunk beds instead of just one. I mean, is there anything we can do to kind of reduce the densification of these type of projects, or is it they're allowed up to the 14 as we kind of have discussed based on the CUP?
They're allowed up to the 14.
So like on the prior one we just reviewed, could they have technically gone up to 14 there if they wanted?
If it complies with the zoning code, there is a possibility, yes.
As long as there's the 50 feet per
resident.
Yeah. So it kind of comes back to, I mean, I thought Commissioner Donahue really kind of teed it up and summed it up well, where it was like, you know, the council kind of has already, you know, vetted this concept. And as Megan noted, it's if there's concern or, you know, interest in changing it, it's got to go back to the council level.
I think there are conditional use findings that I think are built into the resolution. And based on those findings, if you find that there's something that isn't being met, you could contemplate adding additional conditions so long as there's a tie to those findings. So I don't know, Courtney, if you want to remind the commission about the findings that they make for conditional use permit.
Yes, here we are in the second CUP. Perhaps this conversation should have happened at the first one. On your staff report packet, there is a resolution. Conditional use permits are outlined in the zoning code as a land use application process. Three standard conditions come into play on a conditional use permit. And keep in mind that conditional use permits are intended for uses that are not permitted uses by right. They're discretionary. In other words, there is a judgment call that can be exercised by a planning commission body, or in some cases by staff. This discretionary process requires that findings be established. The first finding is the environmental finding, and it's just a standard CEQA, or what we call California Environmental Quality Act finding. In this case, it's exempt. The second finding looks at the general plan, it looks at the zoning code, and it makes sure that the use is consistent with the purposes of that district. In this particular case, it's residential. It probably fits that finding fairly straightforwardly. But that's a judgment call that should be examined by each commissioner or independent judgment. The third finding is the condition or the finding that deals with the general plan. It deals with whether the use may be detrimental to the public health or to the safety or the welfare of the persons that live or work near the location of the particular use. So these conditional use permits are location dependent. Each site or each location must be independently analyzed conditionally. There's another detrimental statement that comes up regarding improvements in the vicinity. In this particular case, we're not constructing anything new, or the applicant isn't constructing anything new, but it is a use. And the commission may or may not agree with the staff recommendation. The third finding, or the fourth finding in the list of the string of findings, and staff has assembled evidence supporting the conditional use permit. But again, the Planning Commission can choose an alternative. They can disagree with the staff recommendation. They can go a different direction. The fourth finding deals with conditions. Will this project or will this use be able to comply with the zoning code? In this particular case, there are certain conditions, and it's a question that the commission needs to look at is, will it comply with the provisions of the zoning code, including specific conditions regarding the proposed use? But the meat and potatoes, I think, really come from the second CUP finding, or number three on the resolution, which is starting at the bottom of page two. And that's where the community, the public health, the safety, the welfare of the area come into play with this particular use. Yes. Does that cover the what you're thinking of, Megan?
Yeah, yes, exactly. I think, you know, if there's something that a condition that you think is important that you'd like to see that could be tied to those findings, I just didn't want to get into the argument of occupancy up to 14, because that's what, you know, the zoning code ordinance allows. But if you can tie some occupancy restrictions that make sense in relation to what Courtney just read, a good one might be, you know, 14 people, you know, would be problematic because they're going to have, you know, how are you going to address the car situation? There are going to be cars all over, and that could be detrimental to the neighborhood. And the condition that you can impose, as we have, is obviously having providing transportation and pickup and so forth, so that you would limit, you know, how that occupancy would have impacts on the neighborhood. So those are, that's like a condition that can be tied to some of the things that Courtney mentioned.
Mr. Munzo, any questions?
Yeah, I still don't think that gets back at the core issue that you don't want us to go to, Megan, which is the occupancy number, right, that the council has already designated. I don't see anything in the third finding around space. And I know, I think it was Ms. Ruck that said it was 50 feet per individual. So I'm wondering if that's something that could be included as far as like safety. And I guess this is a question probably to Mr. Wiles first and then maybe the applicant, but the reason why there's a higher occupancy at this particular place is because of the because it's residential medium and because of the number of restrooms, or I'm just trying to understand the number 14, like so high.
They have proposed 14 for this location. They would require 700 square feet of living area, and it's actually a 2,579 square foot dwelling unit. And so the applicant has requested this particular location be acceptable for 14 employees rather than the 10 employees.
And the 50 feet actually come direct out of the ordinance itself. And it should be noted that it's for sleeping areas, not shouldn't include kitchens or bathrooms or hallways.
So there's no use in including that because that's already part of the ordinance, right? It's already.
Yeah, we already evaluated for that and evaluated on the bathrooms.
Okay, that's it for me.
Mr. Noor?
No comments or questions at this time.
Okay, I have one comment, and you know, it seems to be that the opinion is being put forward here that the city council has pretty much already approved this, so we don't have any choice. Well, we have a choice. We have a choice either to approve or deny. And if we deny the CUP, then they have the authority to appeal it to the city council, or if we make no decision at all, then it automatically goes to the city council. I just wanted to clarify on that. Giving that statement, are there any comments from the public regarding this item?
Yes, there is. And there are those that were included and made part of the record. And then there's another one that we received on January 5th from Rosa Gonzalez. It reads, dear representatives, I'm strongly against the conditional use permit CUP 2020-009 coming into my neighborhood. I have lived in the Montebello community since 2005. This project is set to go in on the corner of where I live. I live in a residential area, and I think this is a really bad idea. Crime is already so high in this neighborhood. I am taken aback by the Planning Commission entertaining such a plan. We are in the middle of a serious pandemic, and you're wanting 14 unrelated people to live in that home. Again, it is a residential area not intended for farm worker housing project. If I understand correctly, there is a loophole that was established just for this very application. So a farmer bought a home in my neighborhood and now is asking to convert this home on the corner of where I live into farm worker housing project. I've noticed the farm worker housing project going in on Rossi and Davis, and I think that is such a good project for our farm workers. I'm asking that you consider this project coming into your neighborhood and reject this application. Quite concerned, Rosa Gonzalez, a resident citizen of the area. And that concludes this comment. We also have three other attendees. If any of you would like to make a statement, please raise your hand.
With three other what?
Okay, we have Lasuera Rodriguez who's requesting to make a statement. I will unmute your microphone and provide you with 2-minute time limit. Mr. Meeks, if you'd like to extend the time, you may do so.
Yes, please. If we could have her brought online, please.
Yes. Hello.
So I would just like to ease your minds a little bit. For some background, so we've been doing H2A housing since 2006. So some of these homes we've owned for a while. At one point, actually, Verona, before the city got involved in regulating the number of residents, the state allowed us to put 18 people in that house. And yeah, it was pretty tight. But I don't think we've ever had problems there. So the people have been living there for years, workers, and we've never had any problems there as far as I know, at least since I came in, nothing. But just to ease your minds, we have no intention of making this a permanent solution. Like I said earlier, we have a housing project going into Spence Road, and we've been backtracked because of the pandemic and all of these things. So at one point or another, all of these homes will no longer be used for that. We're getting homes, pre-manufactured homes built specifically to the specs the state has laid out for us. And, you know, we just need time basically to finish this project so we can continue to operate our business. And, you know, eventually we'll get them all out there. We're hoping no longer than a year or two.
And what is our assurance that you will do that?
I have Maureen Brock, who's also working on that same project. And I've had dialogue with Megan and Lorenzo since I came in, and you know, any type of assurance you need, we're more than happy to submit our plans that we have going into Spence Road. I've spoken to a few of the county supervisors about it. It's an ongoing process. We've actually already invested in a well. We had a well, and we were asked to put in a second well, which we've already done, and it's just we've been slowed by that process.
I understand that. Additional to add on to that, Mr. Rodriguez, once your Spence Road property is open, what do you intend to do with this house and this residence?
We've you know, discussed many options. You know, we all have kids, so we, you know, all entertain the idea of, you know, just passing it down to our kids, renting them out. You know, nothing's, we own other properties. And what I was telling Maureen is we're not into taking advantage of people. I actually own an apartment complex on Williams, and our rents are, you know, $800 for a one bedroom, $1,000 for a two bedroom. We're not, you know, looking to get rich at other people's expense. So we'd go somewhere. I actually own two other homes in Montebello, which I rent out at market value or below. So that's always another option for us. As far as employee housing, though, as soon as Spence Road is finished, that's where we're going to go. It makes sense for us because at some point soon, they're going to have what's called a transportation pay. So we're going to be paying people even when they're on our buses. So it makes more sense in mm-hmm. so many different standpoints to just have them in one central location where they will be picked up and dropped off. And, you know, we're not going from one house to another, picking up three employees here, four employees there. So that's our goal. If, you know, if anybody has any contacts in the county or state that can help speed up the process, we'd appreciate it. It's been a journey so far.
So, Mr. Rodriguez, would you be amenable then for the CUP to have a sunset clause so that once your temporary use of these residential units is no longer needed and your project is completed, that they would revert back to single family use?
Yes, definitely. Yes.
Okay.
Thanks. Mr. Rodriguez, any other commissioners' questions for Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Certainly not. Mr. Wiles, could you bring back up the slide that shows me the Williams Road, more or less like it's an overhead aerial shot?
That one,
yes.
One thing too, I just wanted to defer to our city attorney, but I don't think we can put a sunset clause on a CUP, but there might be another possible way of addressing the comment. So I wanted maybe Chris to weigh in if he has a minute on that.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, thanks, Megan and commissioners. So you cannot put a sunset clause in the conditional use permit, but we can if the property owner is willing, have them voluntarily enter into a deed restriction that says it would revert back to just a single family house without the H2A farm worker housing in it when it ends. So that'd be another way to address, I think, the concerns that I'm hearing.
Okay. Now, my question for Mr. Rodriguez is, it shows your pickup. Could you bring the slide back up, please? The overhead shot? Yes, that one. My question, Mr. Rodriguez, is it shows your pickup point across Williams Road, right in front of the elementary school. Is there a different place you could pick them up? Because that's a hazardous way to get across Williams Road. I could easily see one of your farm workers getting killed trying to cross. Is Mr. Rodriguez no longer with us? I don't know who the planter is.
There's I see that Mr. Panzer. Oh no, he's back.
Okay. Here we go. Yeah, so it's a process to get the mic on because I have to click the raise your hand and until okay. It's unmuted on your end. But we're open to picking them up anywhere. We just don't want them, obviously, for the neighborhood's sake and to go into the streets themselves.
If I recall correctly, I think there's a bus stop on the right-hand side of Williams Road as you're heading towards Old Stage Road.
Yes, and I believe if it's there, we're more than open to that. It might even be a closer walk for them. So yes, definitely.
The reason I ask that is I'm very familiar with the area. I live in that area, and people get hit by cars all the time crossing Williams Road.
Yes. Okay. Yes, and
you're willing to consider that.
Definitely. And especially because most of these workers are getting picked up at midnight, so I wouldn't want them crossing the street in the dark. So I'm pretty happy with that. Yes.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments for Mr. Wiles?
Before we continue, we have one more public comment.
Okay.
Maureen Ruff. Okay.
Go ahead. Mr. Ponzi.
Hold on just a second. Let me get Maureen.
All right, Maureen.
Mr. Ponzer, go ahead.
Maureen.
Hi, my hand was up to answer the earlier question when Josh disappeared for a moment.
Okay.
Maureen?
Yes, my hand was simply up to answer the question when Josh disappeared for a moment.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so the question's been asked and answered.
Yes, asked and answered.
Pardon?
Asked and answered.
Thank you. Commission Secretary, you said there's one other person that would like to speak?
No, that was Ms. Rudd. You can go ahead and close for public comment. I don't see anybody else.
Okay.
And the one thing I did want to confirm, because we didn't ask Mr. Rodriguez as if he would be open to the voluntary deed restriction. And also I wanted to ask the commission if you wanted to extend that to the previous CUP.
I would.
I'd like to ask that question too. Mr. Rodriguez, are you still with us?
Yes. And yes, I would be open to that and open to all three homes that we're applying for.
Thank you.
And then Chris, I had a point of order. Would they have to go back and revote to add that condition for Pierce?
No, I don't think so. We just heard Mr. Rodriguez say that he's willing to do it on all three properties. We've already dealt with one. We can't go back to that one. We can't talk about the other because we're not yet there yet. But we will prepare those for, assuming the commission approves these next two for all three, and then have Mr. Rodriguez sign those and record them against the property.
Okay, great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, given that, do we have any other further questions for Mr. Wiles?
Given that, the motion is for a conditional use permit for 20-20-009, request to establish and operate employee housing medium project with a maximum of 14 employees within an existing two-story, 2,579 square foot single family detached dwelling unit with a two-space six. Oh, that's, wait a minute, that's the right one. No. Yeah, 67% reduction at 1569 Verona Court in the residential medium density Mountain Valley plan overlay airport overview RM-3.6-SP-5-AR zoning district. We have a motion and a second.
Go ahead, Commissioner Monto.
Yeah, I was going to move with the motion and including the deed restriction on the property.
I'll second that.
Okay, given a motion and a second. And I've already clarified the motion. That's to approve. I assume, yes, it's to approve. That's the motion on the table. And with that motion from Commissioner Monzo and a second from Commissioner Knorr, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Aye.
Commissioner Armando?
Aye.
Commissioner Norn?
Yes.
Chairperson Meeks?
Yes, and given the condition that was added, I'd like to amend my vote on the previous one to yes.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Commissioner Chairman Meeks, you can't do that unless we reconsider the whole item, so.
Okay, never mind. Never mind, it stands as.
All right,
as
thank you.
Okay, so conditional use permit number 20-20-009, conditional use permit 20-20-009, request to establish and operate an employee housing medium project with a maximum of 14 employees within an existing two-story, 2,579 square foot single family detached dwelling unit with a two-space, 67% parking reduction located 1569 Verona Court and residential medium density Mountain Valley specific land overlay airport overlay R-M-3.6-SP-5.5-AR zoning district is approved. The request for a conditional use permit, which cannot be issued for 10 days during this 10-day period. Any person having standing to do so under the law who is aggrieved by this action or decision may file an appeal with the Community Development Department located at 65 West Alisal Street. And the commission, that will be put on the, we'll have you put that on the, never mind. Okay, I'm getting tired, that's what it is. Okay. ID 21-001 conditional use permit 20-20-010, request to establish and operate an employee housing medium project with a maximum of 14 employees within an existing two-story, 2,044 square foot single family detached dwelling unit with a one-space 33% parking reduction located 999 Rock Rose Street in the residential medium density Williams Road specific plan overlay R-M-3.6-SP-2 zoning district. Mr. Wiles, would you please present your presentation?
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Conditional use permit 2020-010 is similar to the other two. Main difference is that there is a two-car garage with this one, so it's only one space parking reduction is 33%, it's 14 employees. The zoning is residential medium density 3.6, located in Williams Ranch Pacific Plan overlay. This has actually kind of a loft, so it's kind of a two-story. It's pretty much the same background. There was no protest received on this one. The pickup spot is actually right adjacent to the house, so it's pretty much it's walked to the pickup spot because there is a bus stop right next to it. So that's the reason why it's bus stop 95. So it's right adjacent to them. And so that's pretty much the the same public comments and CEQA determination exempt per section 15301 existing facilities. As I said earlier, there was no protest received on this one. And the noticing and the publishing on December 23rd, similar to the other CUP. So just a recommended motion, the same as the others. So motion to approve the resolution, finding the project exempt from CEQA, and approving conditional use permit 2020-010. Any questions for the commissioners at this time?
You're muted.
Commissioner, any questions for Mr. Wiles?
I appreciated what you had brought up, John, around the safety of the workers getting to the bus stop. And I know this one's really close, but it looks like there's not a crosswalk there. Or can we see that again?
Yes, let me bring it up.
Commissioner Gonzalez, you'll see it here. The bus stop is located right around the corner from the unit. It's on the same side of the street.
Oh, great. Great, thank you.
It's a little blue square with the bus in it. It's hard to see, but it's there. Yep.
Thank you, yes.
Any other further questions, Commissioner Gonzalez?
None.
Okay. Commissioner Manzo, any questions for Mr. Wiles?
No questions.
Commissioner Knorr, any questions for Mr. Wild?
None at this time.
And I have no questions for him. Planning Secretary, any comments from the public regarding this item?
All public comments received were those made part of the record. None received after the cutoff.
Okay. I'll ask one more time. Are there any questions or comments from the commissioners from Mr. Wiles? Commissioner Gonzalez?
None.
Commissioner Manzo?
No.
Commissioner Knorr?
No.
And I have no questions. Okay. So do we have a motion and a second?
I'll make a motion for recommending approval with the amendment of the deed restriction as the previous item.
Mr. Callahan, do we have to have him come online and agree to that for this item?
No, sir. He did previously with his comments, so we're good.
Okay, thank you. So, and do we have a second?
Yes, I second it.
I'm sorry. So we have a motion from Commissioner Knorr and a second from Commissioner Manzo. And the motion is to approve a conditional use permit number 20-0010, request to establish and operate an employee housing medium project with a maximum of 14 employees within an existing two-story, 2,044 square foot single family detached dwelling unit with a 33% parking reduction located at 999 Rock Rose Street and residential medium density Williams Ranch Pacific Plan Overlay R-M-3.6-SD-U zoning district. May we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Aye.
Commissioner Manzo?
Aye.
Commissioner Knorr?
Yes.
Chairperson Meeks?
Yes. So, the request for conditional use permit is approved. The request for a conditional use permit, which cannot be issued for 10 days during the 10-day period, any person having standing to do so under the law who is aggrieved by this action or decision, may file an appeal with the Community Development Department located at 65 West Alice South Street. Other business. ID number 21-001, the Planning Commission meeting calendar. Mr. Grossman?
Yeah, for next Planning Commission meeting, it's scheduled January 20th. We have 1054 University coming back again to the Planning Commission? Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. Am I missing one of the items? I might have skipped over the calendar.
Yeah, I asked you about the calendar.
Sorry, I was thinking calendar for Planning Commission. My bad. A calendar has been prepared by staff and it is shared on the screen. It's the same manner of Planning Commission meetings. It's the first Wednesday and the third Wednesday of every single month. I don't think we lose out on any meetings this year due to the holidays. So congratulations. We have a lot of meetings in front of us this year.
Sounds good to me.
Of course.
Maybe we'll actually get to meet in person one before the end of our term here.
That would be great. And of course, we will cancel any meetings due to lack of business, as before.
So you're talking about upcoming meeting on the 20th of 1454 University.
Yes, thank you.
Continued from before.
Yes, we'll have the 1054 University revised plans came in. Staff is looking at those plans right now. There are some new facade features that are proposed on the front of the building, and it's under review. We'll prepare a report and get back to the commission on that shortly. The next item is a cannabis appeal. This was continued from November 18th. It's on Sanborn, and that report is underway right now. Hopefully, I should receive it soon from our consultant. And I believe that summarizes the 20th.
Did you say that location for the appeal is on Sanborn?
Yes, Sanborn Place. It's kind of near US 101.
Okay.
Pilot truck stop down there on the other side.
Okay, thank you. And you said any future agenda items?
Just those three, University, Sanborn, and no, just those two, right? Just the two items. Navajo goes to February.
Okay, so the next regular scheduled meeting is the 20th of January, 2021. Will I see at least you three there?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, got a nod. So, thank you. It's been a long one. Hope you have a good evening. The meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Bye.